So everybody ready?
So welcome again on this platform.
Thank you.
On behalf of Beyond Law CEO and ULS Punjab University Chandigarh, we welcome you again on this platform. The pleasure of hearing you on a different platform rather than as a judge while judging us as well as while delivering the judgments was always a different treat for us, but hearing you on a virtual platform on topics which are engaging and as well as engrossing for the legal minds and a common man is again a pleasure. So we would actually start the webinar at 5 o'clock. We would just like to know what has your experience on these virtual platforms, how you're finding it different from the normal seminars, etc. which you did?
No, let me tell you frankly, there are both advantages and some shortcomings also. Advantages are that you have been able to hold so many webinars and any cost to be incurred. You don't have to arrange for some auditorium, some sitting arrangements, some tea and snacks, etc., and refreshments, people coming, making their arrangements of coming and going, etc., all that paraphernalia, all those protocols are not required. And we are able to connect with each other. And another good thing is that it seems as if you are chatting with each other, so that these are good things. But at the same time, when in a physical form and people are there in an auditorium, 100, 200, 300 people or 500, you see them, you are able to connect with them. So here, as far as audience is concerned, we are not able to connect with them. So obviously that is not there, but all said and done, yes, they are hearing and it is a good thing. Another remark which I would make is that now, of course, since it is very easy to conduct in the sense that you have to arrange for the speakers and made all those and the way you have to follow it up, do the running about in that sense. Running means on mails or on phones, etc. That takes your time. But now there are so many organizations, so many such portals which are having so many webinars that we flooded with it. That is the second thing which I will say. That's everybody. I'm receiving invitation 3 or 4 mails every day. So it is now becoming difficult for me to say yes to everybody because there's no such time that you can say yes to everybody. Like whole of the May, I'm totally booked.
So the only advantage is, like I'm just saying, in the morning I had received only a WhatsApp message from Professor Meeta Agarwal. She is teaching in Uttarakhand. She said that she wants to connect. So in this way, otherwise in a normal webinars or in normal seminars, we could only have connected through people only of one particular area.
Yes. And we had from not only India. I mean, if you have a reach person from anywhere in the world can come and connect.
And so much so, we are also live on Facebook. I will just unmute Meeta Agarwal before we formally go. She's been teaching in Uttarakhand. It was a pleasure. The first message which I received in the morning that we want to connect you. Over to you, Dr. Meeta.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thanks. It's very nice to connect you. It's first time ki through this webinar. I am able to see sir, Honorable Sir, Justice Sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Yes, sir, we are at 5. As usual, the rituals shouldn't go. Welcome you back again on this platform, sir. On behalf of Beyond Law CLC and ULS Punjab University Chandigarh, we have organized another webinar which, according to us, would engage people because, as the topic itself says, proportionality balancing the scales of justice. The fact that the justice has always been correlated with the balance is a fact known to one and everyone, not only to a common man, but as well as the professionals, especially the students and the lawyers. And how to maintain the balance and to learn that nuances. We have amongst us Honorable Mr. Justice A.K. Sikri, former judge of the Supreme Court of India, who is also presently in the Singapore International Committee, Commercial Court of Singapore. That gives credentials to the fact that the people in Singapore have just latched to his legal knowledge and nuances. He's himself created a niche as a legal Dion. We can all say that he's himself, though given judgments on constitutional law, but he is an institution and constitution within himself. Without taking much time, I will just ask the partners of this webinar, Professor Ratan Singh, to say a few words, a formal introduction to Justice Honorable Mr. Justice A.K. Sikri. Over to you, Professor Ratan Singh.
Yeah, thank you, Vikasji. Vikasji, in fact, just after listening, Lordship, on the Constitution and constitutionalism in my last webinar, probably that was a very thought-provoking ideas and perceptions which the Lordship had shared with us. As far as right, each and every corner of the Constitution he has touched upon. Now, when we are talking about the proportionality, and we do understand that this is the universal principle of administration of justice. And this proportionality, when we talk about, this is only the yardstick which measure the rational relationship between the ends and the means of the decision. And measuring the ends and the means of the decision, sometimes the three points and the three issues come before the decision-making body. Like, for instance, when the decision-making body is to decide and they think about this is too big, this is too small, or this is just right. So out of all these things, they have to be very rational, very legitimate expectation. Accordingly, they have to go. They have to take care about the principles of natural justice, and they have to watch the true spirit of the Constitution and the legislation. So the Lordship over which is to speak over about the proportionality. Now, what I feel is being a student of law and that too particularly about the constitutional law, this is the topic over which I think most of the students and even the academicians and maybe the professionals, they are not aware much about the different theories and different perspectives and different observations of the different judges also. So I think today's webinar, listening to Lordship, will be a feast for the day, and this will be too much for my students, my other colleagues, those who are in the academics. Sir, the University Institute of Legal Studies, the partner with this Beyond Law CLC.
We know that, I know.
We are running with this 5-year course of BLLB and BCom LLB. And our students are at national level and at international level. They are really bringing the laurels for us. And it's just a about 14, 15 years old institution has produced much of the results. So I, on behalf of University Institute of Legal Studies and CLC, sir, welcome you on this platform. And I'm very sure your thought-provoking ideas, perceptions, and the juristic points will definitely be enlightened us. Thank you very much, sir, and welcome back.
Thank you. So can I start? Should I start?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We are live on Facebook also.
Okay. Now, good evening to all of you, not only the organizers, each and every person who is here attending this webinar. My good wishes in this COVID-19, again, I say stay safe and remain protected. Of course, utilize the time in a most productive manner, which you have been doing, which includes these webinars as well. And I commend Mr. Chathat and the university, including Professor Ratan and others, that they are coming together and they have organized a series of such webinars. As I have seen now, I was sent today only, there have been more than 20, I think, webinars already.
Sir, more than 38.
More than 38, and very important topics, most of them, they are there. So they must be enriching the participants in their contents, etc., making more, wiser, etc. So congratulations to all of you. coming to the topic of the day, I chose this topic when last time, if you remember, as I spoke on constitution and constitutionalism, and when I was talking about the principles of constitutionalism and negative constitutionalism, which talks of limited government and which talks of protecting the human rights and liberties, etc., and protecting the interest of the minorities. And on the other hand, positive constitutionalism, which talks of a welfare state where the egalitarian state should be there. There should be, for the downtrodden and marginalized section of the society also, justice should be there. So this is the function of the state, to have both aspect of the constitutionalism. And I said that in between these two, rest what we call rule of law. Your rule of law becomes more pivotal in attaining or in achieving this constitutionalism, both negative as well as positive aspects of constitutionalism. And as far as rule of law is concerned, it has to be enforced by the courts at the end of the day. And therefore, it becomes a duty of the courts to protect the constitution, to protect the democracy, to protect the rule of law, and to enforce that rule of law. And at that stage, I stated, just by way of reference only, I mentioned that many tools which are adopted in order to achieve this constitutionalism, one of them is proportionality. This is in that sense, but naturally there was neither any time nor we could have focused on what proportionality is and in what manner proportionality is able to achieve the rule of law. And as we have tilted or modified it little to balance the scales of justice, that is to ensure that justice on both sides is there and it is balanced. So that would be my focus today. In detail, I would be now trying to project and how the courts have used this instrumentality or the doctrine of proportionality in arriving at the justice which is just and which is fair and which balances both the sides of the two sides which are present come before the court, and it is to be seen. Now let me start with this, that as far as proportionality is concerned, it has got different connotations in different contexts. I'll come to those contexts, and therefore, based on those contexts, the connotations and the doctrine of proportionality or the basis of proportionality will also be somewhat different. Of course, the golden thread that runs is balancing the scales of justice in all these cases, but then it would be viewed in a different context. For the sake of today's lecture, and my today's speech, I have thought of taking up three or four, you can call it, subsets of these proportionality and three spheres or three fields. One is how we have seen this proportionality in criminal law. Then second is how we have seen this proportionality in service matters. And third is in administrative law. Of course, when it comes to service matters and administrative law, there would be some overlap insofar as concept is concerned, conceptual aspect of this is concerned. But then there would be, I said, apart from that, some overlap as far as the focus of the judges or the way the judges have to go into and apply in service law. Because service law is also an aspect of administrative law in that sense, but then other matters of administrative law, there would be some difference in the perception. So therefore, I'm therefore segregating service law from administrative law, because when I come to proportionality concept, what are the changes there between the two, I'll be demonstrating that. And the fourth and the most important, according to me, is, which was a part of constitutionalism last time, I said that in the constitutional law, when the fundamental rights of the citizens are at stake and there's some restrictions on those fundamental rights, how the doctrine of proportionality is used in order to balance the two sides. So that's why I said the balancing the justice scales of justice in applying the proportionality. In so far as simple terms, when we talk of proportionality, that means it should be something done which is in proportion to the act. So in the context of criminal law, as I said, it would be it would come into play in sentencing. A person has committed a crime or not is matter of fact. If suppose a person is charged of say cheating under section 420 and some acts which he has done, and whether it amounts to cheating or not, on whether he has done or not, evidence would be led. On evidence, acts are proved, then the law question of law would be decided whether it amounts to cheating or not within the framework of section 416 to 420 of the IPC. But having said so, when it comes to sentencing, then the question is that how the doctrine of proportionality is used. It is used in that sense that, look, the punishment which is to be awarded now by the court should be proportionate to the gravity of the offense. So here proportionality comes into play in that sense, in limited sense. So I would be first touching upon this for very few minutes, and then service law for a few minutes, and then I'll come to, because the concept of proportionality, how it has evolved in recent times insofar as constitutional law is concerned, I'll be devoting some more time to that. Now, therefore, general observation that it has to be, it has different connotation in different contexts. Of course, at the same time, the main purpose is to ensure that the criteria of fairness and justice in the statutory interpretation is used, and that runs across all the four aspects of the proportionality, all the four areas in which the law of proportionality, the doctrine of proportionality is to be prescribed. Now, and so far as criminal law is concerned, it is at two levels. First of all, I would say in the first place, it is incorporated in the IPC itself. Now, take for example, Section 53 of the Indian Penal Code. Section 53 talks of punishments, and it says, Section 53, the punishments to which offenders are liable under the provisions of this court are, first, death; secondly, imprisonment for life; thirdly, is omitted by amendment; fourthly, imprisonment which is of two descriptions, namely rigorous, that is with hard labor, and simple; then fifthly, forfeiture of property; sixthly, fine. So it starts from fine. A mere fine of maybe 100 rupees, 50 rupees, maybe 10 rupees, you know, traffic violation, 100 rupees fine. That is also, in a way, traffic violation is also offense which is committed by a person. But this, which is very, very most trivial in that sense. And going up to the death, which may be generally in the cases of murder, etc. But then there are many offenses where death punishment is prescribed. So therefore, this section itself incorporates the doctrine of proportionality. And it says that, look, merely because a person has committed the crime does not mean that all the criminals are to be given the same punishment. When it depends on the gravity of the offense, as the gravity goes more, the sentence can be more. So that is at first level. And this is so stated even in CRPC. If you see section 360 of CRPC, which says, for awarding proportionate punishment in the light of certain mitigating circumstances and certain keep in mind, like the age of the person. If the person is 18 years, less than 18 years, and he is juvenile, naturally the punishments are different, and this person can't be even taken. That is because of the Juvenile Justice Act. But of course, age is a consideration which becomes, but age becomes a consideration if a person is very old, 80 years of 75, 80 years of old, then that may become a mitigating factor. Then character or antecedents of the offender, which will be seen, and even the sex, like if the person is a female, and in those circumstances, the sentence may vary. So these two things are contained in IPC and CRPC itself. Of course, Section 360 is in a second level, I would say. First level, I say that, as I have said, IPC itself recognizes. Second level, again, IPC recognizes, but in what form? Here, as far as Section 53 is concerned, punishments are different for different offenses. But IPC recognizes different punishment even of same offense. Say, in what form? Say, suppose I gave you the example of cheating, or take any other offense, it will say maximum punishment is prescribed, up to 7 years, up to 10 years, up to life, death. It may prescribe minimum, may not prescribe minimum. So therefore, when it says up to, that means two persons who are convicted of cheating and the maximum punishment is 7 years, one may be awarded 1 year, other may be awarded 5 years. Why? Again, doctrine of proportionality comes. That is what is to be kept in mind. Of course, this is applied most of the time, and our judges, like in the district courts, the magistrates and the session judges, are doing day in and day out. And I would say that this not consciously thinking, I think they are applying, yes, gravity of offense is there, so we'll give more punishment. But at the back of the mind, which they may not be stating in the order, is the proportionality. So a case of cheating, where a person, suppose he is an employee in an organization, and he has cheated, say, for a few hundred rupees or a few thousand rupees, he's an employer, is a different case of cheating like a Nirav Modi who has cheated a bank for 10,000 crores or 20,000 crores of rupees. Both cases may be cases of cheating. But then gravity of the two acts of cheating is totally different. So therefore, the inherent in the system, in the IPC itself, discretion is given to the court. And this discretion and how much punishment should be given depends upon the gravity of the offense. And therefore, the doctrine of proportionality comes. Unlike US, where they have a sentencing policy. In India, we don't have sentencing policy. It is a discretion of the court, which is to be exercised, of course, on objective consideration, and those considerations are spelled out by the courts from time to time, Supreme Court has said, and which I'll indicate briefly. But what I'm saying is that in a where there's a sentencing policy, then there's hardly, like in US, there's hardly any discussion with the court. They say, first time offender, this kind of offense, this much punishment. So if it is 7 years, he'll give 7 years. Because that is stated in the policy which is given to him. If it is second offense, so 7 years, it may go to 20 years. And there, if you know, the punishments, sometimes imprisonment is given for 300 years. We know that the person will not live up to that, but then that is in the sentencing policy. But unlike that, in India, we have the discretion is given to the court, and if this discretion is exercised based on the proportionality, that is the gravity, and we have to keep in mind while awarding the sentence that it is not disproportionate to the nature of the crime. And that has been stated by the court, Supreme Court, and of course courts also from time to time. And if I may read some of the passages from some judgments, in Santa Singh versus State of Punjab, this is 1976, 4 SCC 190, the Justice P.N. Bhagati has said, a proper sentence is the amalgam of many factors, such as the nature of the offense. He did not use the word proportionality, which is used in later cases, but nature of offense means proportionality, the circumstances extenuating and aggravation of the offense, the prior criminal record of the offender, the age of the offender, record of the offender as to employment and background of the offender, etc., his education, home life, society, all those factors which are stated. We are on proportionality, as I said, and which was very specifically stated in Sonam versus State of Kerala, and that is in 2013-11 SCC, where they said that while exercising discretion in sentencing, the factors like proportionality, deterrence and rehabilitation should be kept in mind. Now we know, as far as sentencing is concerned, why a person who has committed a crime is sentenced or he is sent to jail. the purpose, as we know, the philosophy behind sentencing is that it should act as deterrent, that the society should learn that no commission of crime, if the crime is committed, they may be punished for that. And therefore, they deter from committing the crime. And then at the rehabilitation, as it said, that the person is sent so that we say that jails are not only for the purpose of doing their rigorous, if rigorous imprisonment is awarded, going and doing manual work, time given to them to rehabilitate so that after completing the sentence, when they come, they are reformed persons. And that is why jails have so many, we said that model jails are those which have all those rehabilitation schemes, etc. And the third is proportionality. How much sentence should be given? This is said. And in state of MP versus Bablu Nath, there are so many judgments where it is stated time and again. One of the prime objectives of the criminal law is the imposition of adequate, just, proportionate punishment. The word uses proportionate punishment. And likewise, in the another case, Alistair Anthony, in state of Maharashtra 2012, 2 SCC 648, the Supreme Court again said, one of the prime objectives of the criminal law is the imposition of an appropriate, adequate, just, and proportionate sentence. And in Hazara Singh versus Rajkumar, again 2013, 9 SCC 516, the court said the punishment awarded should be directly proportionate to the nature and magnitude of the offense. This is the concept of proportionality which is brought. The benchmark of proportionate sentencing can assist the judge in arriving at a fair and impartial verdict. So therefore, as far as criminal law is concerned and sentencing is concerned, it is entirely based on the test of or the doctrine of proportionality. Two things, if you say, I may add here before closing this aspect of criminal law, is that in the cases of murders, etc., or where the death penalty is provided, sometimes the death penalty and minimum punishment is life imprisonment. So no judge can give less than life imprisonment. But at the same time, between the life imprisonment and death penalty, now the law is that death penalty should be awarded in rarest of rare cases. So in rarest of rare cases, again, some element of proportionality comes. Because those rarest of rare cases are those where the courts have said that murder was committed in a diabolical manner, in a manner which was against all the canons of humanity. And so therefore, those are the expressions which are used. And therefore, even the death sentence is to be awarded would be in going by the nature. Of course, as I gave you the example of cheating here, murder, in A may have committed murder and B also may have committed murder. But in one case, death is awarded. In other case, only life imprisonment is awarded. Why? It depends on the magnitude of that crime diabolical nature in which the crime was perpetrated and committed. It will depend on that. And what was the objective behind such a crime? So it would depend on all these factors. And one very interesting case which has come, which is now when the punishment is prescribed and the constitutional, of course, it would have been the part of fourth when I come to constitutional law, but since it relates to criminal law, so I thought that let me use it here only. It came in Vikram Singh versus Union of India, 2015, 9 SCC 502. It was a case where Varisov, section 364A of IPC were challenged. Now, section 364A is a case where the kidnapping with the purpose of committing murder, etc., is there. And of course, the Varis were challenged. They said that death penalty, it was to discourage or rather to deter those who are the terrorists and may commit an offense of kidnapping with a motive to attain some ulterior goals, and then they may commit murder. So extreme punishment is required. But not in other kinds of cases also, because that was a case where a child was kidnapped and then ultimately murdered, and said that it should not apply to such cases. And therefore, the constitutional validity of this provision was challenged in this case. So, but interesting thing is, which is there, of course, the court upheld the constitutional validity. They said, no, in a case where a child is abducted in this manner and this 364A are, the case is covered by that, death penalty can be given and the provision is not unconstitutional. Because when we come to the constitutionality of the provision, then the court can only see, because it's the wisdom of the legislature. The court can only strike down a legislation when it is unconstitutional. That means it offends any of the provisions of the constitution, or it is the law which was made was not within the means of that. It is ultra vires, that the parliament did not have power to make such a law, which was not the case here. So therefore the court said that, look, normally the laws, it is the parliamentary function, and the courts would not cannot strike down on that basis. These are policy decisions and policy matters. But what is important is these 3-4 lines, if I read, that they have said, the remarks are, but if the laws are palpably inhuman or shockingly disproportionate to the gravity of offense for which the same are prescribed. Here it is not, mind you, you please keep this distinction in mind. It is not a judge who is awarding the sentence. Sentence is prescribed in the IPC, which is challenged as unconstitutional on the ground that it is shockingly disproportionate. Court did not accept that in 364A it was shockingly disproportionate. But court accepted the principle that if it is palpably inhuman or shockingly disproportionate to the gravity of offense for which the same is prescribed, the court can interfere with the same. Suppose tomorrow parliament passes a law that for cheating or for theft, death sentence would be given. It's a clear case I'm giving. Then the court can always say that, look, it is shockingly disproportionate because it is palpably inhuman that a person who has committed an act of cheating, you want to hang him. So therefore, the court said that we can't interfere only on the ground it appears to be excessive. But if it is shockingly disproportionate, it's not only disproportionate, the word shockingly also used, that means it shocks the conscience of the court at any reasonable person that such a punishment should not have been given, then even the legislature, can, the act of legislature or that provision can be declared as unconstitutional. So this is how the doctrine of proportionality is applied in criminal law. Then I come to service matters. Now, as you know, as far as service matters are concerned, of course, as I've said, that it's a subset of administrative law when the judicial review is undertaken by the courts in a matter where in a departmental inquiry conducted against an employee, punishment is awarded. There are service rules in all organizations, in government, etc., where again punishment can be from fine, from censure, and from warning up to the stoppage of increment, stoppage of promotion, demotion, and compulsory retirement, and the highest is the dismissal from service. So there also this shows doctrine of proportionality. Depending upon the, if the gravity is not much, then the punishment should be lesser based on that. But and it becomes a part of administrative law, but how other administrative action should be taken, I'll come to that little later, which will make the things interesting. But Mr. Chattat also said that just devote some time on service law also. So I said, okay, I will do. Now we know the principle of as far as domestic, the misconduct of an employee is concerned, and the inquiries held, which we call domestic inquiries, or departmental inquiry or domestic inquiry. Here, the inquiry officer is appointed by the management, and he holds the inquiry before whom management produces the material that this is the misconduct for which he is charged. So therefore, based on that evidence, of course, principles of natural justice are to be followed. The procedure which is laid down, like in CCS, CCA rules, civil services appeal, conduct appeal, etc. rules have to be followed. And once that procedure is followed, the evidence is led and the finding is recorded by the inquiry officer that this person has committed this particular misconduct. Then he submits that report to the disciplinary authority, which we call. So disciplinary authority then again gives a show cause notice which is a, treated as a Karuna Kar case, that it's a part of principles of natural justice, that the opportunity should be given. So the report is provided to the officer, concerned employee, and the concerned employee says that no, why it should be, should not be accepted, etc. After going through all that, the disciplinary authority may concur with the finding of the inquiry officer that no, the misconduct is proved, and based on that, the inquiry officer will give the punishment. Now, what is, when the matter is challenged, the judicial review in these cases is limited. Law is very clear. The courts do not sit as appellate authority. Like suppose a judgment which is given by the magistrate and appeal is filed before the session judge sits as an appellate authority and will say whether the evidence was sufficient to prove the guilt. In a civil case also, when a decree is passed and findings are given and first appeal is filed under section 96 of the CPC, and the first appellate court looks into the entire evidence all over again and come to his own conclusion whether the facts are established or not. But that is not the function of the court while judicial review over the decision of the disciplinary authorities. So it is only the decision making process. That is, that there was no illegality, principles of natural justice was followed, and there was some evidence. Evidence, not that on no evidence the charge is proved. There is some evidence, the findings are not perverse. And now the how much evidence should have been there, how much it should not have been there, the court cannot go, as the courts are not sitting as the appellate court. But even after they accept everything and the misconduct on that basis is proved, the courts have right to interfere with the penalty imposed on the employee if it is disproportionate. Again, the principle of proportionality comes into play in this almost same manner as it is in the criminal law. Here, of course, the yardstick which is applied is little different, and the words are used here. I have told you in criminal law what are the mitigating and extenuating circumstances, what are the aggravating circumstances which the court has to see. So those are the relevant factors. Here the court will only see what was the misconduct. Suppose the misconduct was that the person was absent from duty for 5 days, he came late, or he for 5 days he did not come to the office and did not give the application for leave also. And now on that basis, what is the punishment given? As I said, the giving of this punishment is the discretion of the disciplinary authority, which can give. Court will not normally interfere, but will interfere if it is, again, the words used are same, if it is shockingly disproportionate. The word shockingly, that means it shocks any reasonable person, any reasonable human being, that the court can say that, look, for 4 days or 5 days absence, if a person had 20 years of service record, he had exemplary record, had not committed any irregularity at any time, was given his promotions from time to time, and now for 4 or 5 days he could not come, and suppose his wife became sick, or he had gone to his native place where he became sick and could not attend and could not send the application also from there. Of course, misconduct is committed because he did not. But then it is not, in a case like this, if the punishment of dismissal is given, then the court may say that, look, it is shockingly disproportionate, and sorry, for such an act, the punishment of dismissal should not have been there. It should have been a lesser punishment. And of course, there are two ways normally, how much lesser it should be. Normally the courts have to, because courts are not sitting as a appellate court, as I said, and substituting their judgment for that. The court will normally strike it down and refer it back to the disciplinary authority to award lesser punishment. But many times under 226 High Court, and most of the time under one, because that is the power given to the Supreme Court under Article 142 of the Constitution, many times they don't send it back and they say that according to us, purpose would be served if during all this period he's denied his wages. It happened in 2014, one case, judgment of Justice Loda, where they said that, look, even if he is denied wages and he is reinstated in service, that will meet the ends of justice after so many years. Why we should send it back? But normally it has to be sent back But again, what I am telling you is that the doctrine of proportionality is applied, and if it is shockingly disproportionate, then the cases, if you can want, I can give some of the citations where this proportionality doctrine is, it is in the same manner. Therefore, for paucity of time, I will not be reading all these passages. But again, the words are shockingly disproportionate. B.C. Chaturvedi versus Union of India, 1995, 6 SCC 749. Then Coal India Limited versus Mukul Kumar Chaudhary. This is 2009, 15 SCC 620. And here, I will say one thing, which when I come to administrative law, because as I told you, there is a, some overlap between the service matters and administrative law. There is a concept of reasonableness, which I'll state in detail when I come to third immediately after this, which is a common law concept, which is in a way a facet of doctrine of proportionality, which is applied in Coal India matter. And the court said, one of the tests to be applied while dealing with the question of quantum of punishment would be, would any reasonable employer have imposed such punishment in like circumstances? So this is doctrine of reasonableness in a way, which is common law doctrine. But yes, the court has again said, no reasonable employer would have imposed extreme punishment of removal in like circumstances after discussing. The punishment is not unduly harsh, but grossly excess to the litigation allegation, that is the disproportionate. And again, in this Ranjit Thakur versus Union of India, 1987, 4 SCC, this was applied. And one or two citations, if I give it to you, 2009, 15 SCC 620. And 2014, 9 SCC 315, they are galore, judgment galore, where because normally what happens ultimately at the end of the day, when the employee knows that misconduct is proved, and as well, and in inquiry also principles of natural justice were fairly followed, and there is some evidence, and he knows that the role of the court sitting over this as judicial review is very limited, ultimately, in the courts, as my experience also say, at the end of the day, the every lawyer argues, look, at least reduce the punishment. It should not have been in such cases. But the question, which is a very important question, and I leave it at that as far as this aspect is concerned of service law, which arises is that in applying the principles of shockingly disproportionate in service matter, it is purely discretion of the court, a particular judge, how he perceives the things. I give you a simple example of, say, absence from office for a period of, say, 6 months without informing. Now, I have seen many judgments where one judge would say, no, for such this thing, I mean, even if it was 5 months, 6 months, 3 months, the person should not have been dismissed from service. Other judge would say, no, he is more disciplinarian. He says, no. I mean, how this can be tolerated by any employer that you run away from the office and you elope and you are gone for 6 months and show your face after 6 months and then punishment. So for one judge, it may be shockingly disproportionate. For other judge, it may be reasonable punishment. So it is, as it is said, doctrine of reasonableness, which is itself is a little vague. It depends. But then at the same time, going by so many cases which have come, on the facts of those cases, they provide a good guidelines to the judges as to under what circumstances the punishment should be treated as shockingly disproportionate. So with this, I come to the administrative law. And here, let me tell you, it's a very interesting development of doctrine of proportionality, which has happened in administrative law, and then in a different way in constitutional matters, which I will come to. As far as administrative law is concerned, you know, as of today, and I said in the lecture on constitutionalism also, that when we talk of welfare state, when we talk that the it's a function of any good government, and in order to have good governance, the government should have many policies, many programs for the progress of the people also. It gives much power to the administration at the same time. to exercise those powers, to formulate those policies. Like if I give you a simple example, this COVID situation has given that power where the government is announcing 20 lakh crore package and what should be the schemes for that. So that these are the policy matters, how to revive the economy. So this gives power to the government, to the administration. Now tomorrow when this 20 lakh crore, yes, broad policy would be made by the government, finance minister is announcing that. But when it comes to implementation of that policy at lower level, then whether it is implemented in accordance with the proper guidelines legally, and whether some norms, legal norms are violated, etc. If that happens, because the law is also very clear that you can't pick and choose, you can't distribute largesse as you want. And we have Article 14 of equality, etc. We have the principles of administrative law. We say action should be bona fide, not mala fide. It should be within the framework of the law. It should be based on relevant consideration and not relevant consideration. All those parameters of judicial review of administrative action are there. If such things happen, like we know 2G case, we know coal case, where the court had struck down the allotment of 2G spectrum or allotment of coal mines, when it found that they were the licenses were not given in accordance with law, and the proper procedure was not followed. So these are the, of course, rules of the, I'm generally saying, the administrative law. But how doctrine of this proportionality is introduced in doing it? All of us know, those who are the students of law and professors are also teaching, that in administrative law, the principle which is applied by Indian courts and elsewhere also. I started with common law principle of doctrine of reasonableness, which is normally applied, that any reasonable person will act in that manner or not. But then the famous case, if you remember, is that Wendsbury principle, which we call, of 1948. Decided by the English courts, and the name of the case was Associated Provinces Pictures Houses Limited versus Wendsbury's Corporation. Since the Wendsbury's Corporation was the respondent, it is now widely known as, for 80 years this, or 70, more than 70 years this rule is there, which is known as Wendsbury's rule. And in that case, the House of Lords said that the inquiry can be on three aspects. Number one, any administrative action which is challenged. Illegality, whether such an action is illegal, it is contrary to any provisions of any statute, then it becomes illegal. Irrationality, that it is so irrational, so perverse, so unreasonable that it becomes irrational. And third is procedural impropriety. That means the procedure was not followed in consonance with principle of natural justice, and it was not followed, and there are procedural irregularities or infirmities which have taken place. And procedural irregularity will also include, I said, that while decision making process, the relevant consideration which should have been taken were either ignored, or irrelevant considerations which should have been ignored are taken into consideration, or mala fide, that is principle natural justice, the person who is interested in the matter has taken the decision. Like we have seen the cases where the appointment interview is held, and the one of the candidates who is appearing is related to one of the members of the interview committee. So this is vitiated on the ground of bias, that he had a personal interest in that matter. So all are these elements by these three things. So this is the Wendsbury principle, which was applied by the English courts for quite some time. Then what happens as I trace the history? And of course, I had the opportunity to give judgments when it comes to constitutional law. I will tell that. Even before that, I would say, in Tata Cellular case, 1994, 6 SCC 5651, this was a case of tender, where the allotment or award of a tender was challenged, and case went up to Supreme Court. And what are the parameters in administrative law, Wendsbury's principle, etc., are to be taken. But Supreme Court indicated for the first time, Indian Supreme Court, that proportionality is also the fourth principle. So three principles illegality, irrationality, and procedural impropriety, which are called Wandsworth's principle. Now, fourth principle of proportionality was introduced. What it is, and had in an administrative law, I'll come to that, but I'm tracing the history for timing, which is really interesting. That in Tata Cellular, it was treated as fourth principle. And my idea is to tell you that still, in a way, to some extent, even the Supreme Court is confused in what way this proportionality principle is to be seen. Because in 1994, it is said that it is to be recognized as fourth principle. Thereafter, this one judgment of 1999, which is of Justice M.J. Rao, I'll come to that judgment later. But few years thereafter, that is in 2008, Justice S.B. Sinha, in Moni Shankar versus Union of India, he said something else. Not as a fourth principle, he said that doctrine of unreasonableness, Wandsworth's unreasonableness, is giving way to the doctrine of proportionality. That means proportionality is substituting, not as a fourth principle, but in place of that, it is doctrine. And in the same year, in another judgment, again Justice Sinha, this is State of MP versus Hazari Lal, where he said, Wandsworth stand replaced by proportionality, which means you have to see only proportionality and not those three principles. So you have been able to understand. In Tata Cellular, it is recognized as fourth principle, whereas in these two judgments, it is recognized as a principle in substitution of those three principles. That means as if only proportionality is to be applied. While saying so, the Supreme Court in this Justice Sinha referred to another judgment of the Queen's Bench of England in 2004, where it is case is called E versus Emperor versus State. E versus Secretary of State for Home Affairs, 2004 QB1044, and borrowed those. From there, but let me tell you, in spite of all this, in later years, in all administrative law cases, and even till today, Wandsworth's principle is applied. So therefore, we should accept the position, in spite of this dichotomy, etc., we should accept the position that proportionality is the fourth tool in addition to three tools given by Wandsworth's, but this is also applied. So therefore, but now, how it is almost the same in this way as we stated in service law. In service law, as well as punishment, I told you, the court is not sitting as appellate court. And if there's some evidence on the basis of charges proved, principles of natural justice are followed, there was no mala fide, etc., then the court is not to interfere. But yes, can interfere with the punishment if it is shockingly disproportionate. In the same manner, the inquiry first has to be on the decision-making process. That means applying Wandsworth's principle, any action of the administrator or administrative action, executive action, three principles, illegality, irrationality, and procedural impropriety. But if it meets all these tests, then still question comes of proportionality. But here proportionality, now I'm totally digressing proportionality, what we have seen in criminal matter and in service matter, it is not that kind of proportionality here. What is the test of proportionality? This is very interesting. And for that, as I told you, I'm going back to this 1997, I said that in between Supreme Court had decided one case, where this is described in a beautiful manner. And that paves way for administrative law and ultimately constitutional law also, how it has prevailed. Now, in this the name of the case is Union of India versus G. Ganayutham, Ganayutham, 1997, 7 SCC 463. Now, here it is said, of course, we know, as although I have explained in brief, illegality, it is, if it is against Wandsworth's principle, against any provisions of the statute, it would be illegal, or any guidelines, etc., which have the force of law. Procedural impropriety, if the proper procedure is not followed, principles of natural justice. Irrationality, they said that to characterize an administrative decision as irrational, the court has to hold. Now, what is the test? On material, that it is a decision so outrageous as to be in total defiance of logic or moral standards. That is the test of irrationality. So now, up to now, they are applying the Bensberry's principle, those three principles. But then they say proportionality, because they have distinguished what is Bensberry's principle of reasonableness and vis-a-vis the proportionality, and how they describe proportionality. Proportionality is concerned with the way in which the decision maker has ordered his priorities. Now, it is not shockingly disproportionate, because here the decision is taken, the question is not of punishment and shocking punishment, etc., which was in criminal law and in service matter. So, a particular decision is taken, priorities are ordered, that this should be the first priority, this should be second and third, and in that, how these are priorities are ordered, and the very essence of decision making consists of surely in attribution, how these are attributed of relative importance to the factors of this case. And in that process, what is to be seen is that proportionality used in human rights context involves balancing test and necessity. These two tests which were propounded, balancing test and necessity test, which have become very important today in administrative and more important in constitutional law. Now, what is balancing test? Take that the administration has taken a particular decision, which is now under challenge, which has to some extent robbed an individual of his some rights. But then they are saying that the decision was necessary, it was imperative, it is legal, because if it is illegal, then naturally it goes. I'm talking of administrative law. When I come to constitutional law, we'll talk of fundamental rights. But here, it was some policy decision which is taken. It was necessary in the larger public interest. Now, on the one hand are the rights of an individual. On the other hand, take for an example, a person who's minor, mines, and he has applied for mining license. And because when I give an example, we'll be able to understand these principles better. He has applied for mining license. The area is some forest area or conserved area. Now, the license mining authorities have granted the license, but it is subject to the permission to be given by the forest authorities also. Environment clearance, as we say, is to be given. Now, suppose forest authorities refuse. They refuse on the ground that no, it is going to affect the ecology, etc., of the forest. It will, that particular area will be deforested, which is not good for the environment. Now, the matter comes before the court. He has his right. He had a right to mine because that was the license granted by the mining authority, which is now trampled with or taken away by the forest authorities. Now, the question are priorities. If you remember, I talked of how it has ordered the priorities. The priority there is that no mining, it may not only yield as far as his business is concerned of that miner, particular person who is asking for mining lease, and he has a right to carry on his business, which is a fundamental right. But it is maybe if the mines, any kind of minerals which are mined therefore from, may lead to the welfare of the economy. Also, it may, from that raw material, some production would be there. We will be able to produce some goods. We will be able to export some goods. Those may be good for economy also. On the one hand, that is there. On the other hand, is the no. Forest authorities have said, sorry, our priority is the environment, and we are not going to therefore grant you this permission. The matter comes to. Therefore, if you know in the because since I have given the example of environmental law. The courts in the environmental law has come out with the principle of very famous principle of this development on the one hand, and yes, Shubha, you wanted to say.
Professor Ratan Singh, I will end me. Professor Ratan Singh.
Pardon? Yeah. What is the principle?
Professor Ratan Singh. So meanwhile, I've just seen that Honorable Mr. Justice S.D. Anand had joined. I'll just speak late.
Okay. Okay. Thank you, Justice Anand. Anyway, so therefore,
sustainable development. Sir, people have posted on the chat. Sustainable development.
Sustainable. Before that, I could remember. Thank you. So the person was sustainable. So therefore, development should be there, but it should be not at the cost of the economy. Now, question of priorities come. Here, the doctrine of proportionality comes. Sustainable development also is a principle which has its roots on proportionality. So as I said, it is concerned with how the decision makers has ordered his priorities and how these are attributed in relative importance is given, whether, and that is one. And then it comes to, as I said, balancing and necessity test. We have to balance the two. What is balancing test? The balancing test means scrutiny of excessive onerous penalties or the action which is taken, infringement of rights or interest, and a manifest imbalance of relevant consideration. Suppose that because of some reason, it is totally banned, particular minerals and at all levels. If I give you example, in Goa, mining was banned by the Supreme Court, which still holds. But then it came to, if you talk of the criticism, some people say that, look, it has not balanced Supreme Court has not balanced all the considerations in that sense. It should have been progressive, not that total ban should have been there. But when we are applying this, we have to have relevant, that there should not be imbalance, and that is what the balancing test. And what is the necessity test? Necessity test means that infringement of human rights in question must be by least restrictive alternative. That means, and when I come to, because it is human rights and constitutional law, that whether this was the only mean, banning, or there could have been lesser restriction. If there could have been lesser restriction, then the court should have, or the authority should have imposed those lesser restrictions and should have based its decision on that. So this is how the doctrine of proportionality has been developed insofar as the administrative law is concerned, and not only the three principles which we call as Venturi's principles are taken into consideration, but even the fourth principle of proportionality. With this, let me come to, because it is concerned with that, as I said, the constitutional rights, administrative law, but now we are talking, and I've already started with that when I come to fundamental rights. Now, you see, we have a chapter on fundamental rights. And this chapter discloses so many rights of equality is there, Article 14. If I say, pick up two or three very important rights, Article 19, various freedoms are there. Freedom of speech and expression, freedom of movement, to move around freely, freedom to carry on business, all these freedoms are there. Then we have Article 21. That right to life and liberty, and it cannot be taken away except by the process of law, and process of law has been read now as due process of law. Now, at the same time, if you see like Article 14, when it talks of equality, it doesn't mean absolute equality. It talks of reasonable classification, that there can be different, otherwise, whether he is a peon or he is the managing director, they should be paid the same salary. It is offending right of equality of a person. But then they say that reasonable classification is in the job, in the particular job a person is having. Yes, two persons, say the two persons who are professors, appointed as professors on the same day with same qualification, same, you can't say one lesser salary than the other. So therefore, if they belong to same class, you cannot discriminate. But if the reasonable classification is there, then that is permissible. Likewise, under Article 19, although 19(1) states about these rights, but Article 19(2) to Article 19(6) talk of reasonable restrictions on that also. Now, so none of these rights are absolute rights. Like Article 19(1)(a), freedom of speech, they say, but freedom of speech can be curtailed in the interest of, like, if somebody gives a seditious speech. That doesn't mean if I'm given freedom of speech, I can start criticizing my own country, and it comes within the framework of sedition. I'm not going into those debates where a particular speech comes under sedition or not, and sometimes the government has tendency to rope in each and every speech and say that it is seditious. But I'm not going, but that is there. It should not be scandalous or defamatory to anybody. That doesn't mean if I have right to speak, abusing anybody and everybody the way I want. And so therefore, these are in the interest of the security of the state. So those kind of speeches can't be given. That's why sedition which comes. So therefore, now the question that arises is that if the law is passed or some limitation are imposed on any of these rights, fundamental rights, how to judge the reasonableness, how to judge whether they are excessive or they are not? Here, the courts have started now, Indian courts have started applying the doctrine of proportionality. In 1997, this Union of India Ganyattham judgment, which I said, where they describe proportionality, etc., the court left at that because the question of fundamental right was not involved. It was only an administrative. But very otherwise important observations which were made, which is the law declared and expanded thereafter, is that in administrative law, when we scrutinize a particular thing and we say that the action is arbitrary, the action is taken and it is arbitrary, court, when the court exercises judicial review, it is called secondary review. And then we are applying Venturi's principles, the whether this action was arbitrary or not. But when it is a fundamental right case and the same action is challenged on the ground that it is discriminatory, in both the cases, Article 14 applies. Because Article 14, right to equality, the Supreme Court has held, is anathema to the arbitrariness. So if a particular action is arbitrary, it can be dubbed as violative of Article 14. But when we go into the inquiry of Article 14, then we apply Venturi's principle. When we go into the inquiry of discrimination, so there's a difference, I hope you understand, difference between action is arbitrary or action is discriminatory. So is where it is per se irrational, but then discriminatory means it is discriminating two kinds of people who are equally situated. At least that is the contention of the petitioner, and the court is now going to look into that contention. Here the doctrine of proportionality comes, which is applied and which they call it the primary review. And in nutshell, actually thereafter, I may say, in the case Modern Dental College, if Constitution Bench and Research versus State of Madhya Pradesh, the doctrine of proportionality was expanded in its full form, almost full, I will say, and it took a 360 degree, completed entire thing in Puttu Swami cases, cases on privacy that I'll come to. But this was a case in Modern Dental, if you remember, the admission in MBBS to examination, NEET examination. Earlier, this Supreme Court three-judge bench has said that declared NEET examination as unconstitutional and it cannot be. But which was again came back again in this, and the Constitution bench, what was argued was, particularly with respect to the educational institutions, that look, the right to profession and is a fundamental right under Article 19(1)(g). Of course, education is not a business, so therefore it is not a right of business, but education is treated as profession. So therefore it is my fundamental right. And you say that government or NEET examination would be held, it is infringing my fundamental right of any institution. And minority institution went further. They said that this is a right granted to us under Article 29 and 30 also. So we are infringing our right of minorities then by taking away the process of admission. So in this process, yes, now what happens? Fundamental right is there, which is acknowledged. Now question is whether the limitation on this fundamental right, which is by that particular act, is proper or not, is the question. Here, in order to test the reasonableness, doctrine of proportionality was applied, and it is applied. What was said was that now here for the first time the principles are formulated, how you go about and discuss. First I'll give the other two judgments also, and then I'll sum up the principles at the end in taking next 2-3 minutes. This was I can say that this constituent bench judgment, I was a member of that constituent bench, and I wrote that judgment where I propounded this doctrine of proportionality in great length and describing the entire contours thereof. And then Puttu Swami, that privacy judgment, this issue came before 9-judge bench. So Puttu Swami 1, 9 bench, which was to decide whether privacy is a fundamental right at all or not. So then they, of course, followed this judgment and expanded this little further. And then it was again applied, all those principles in Puttu Swami 2, which became Aadhaar judgment. Of course, it has been applied in so many cases, but then these three judgments are the basic judgments which are laid down the entire contours of the law on proportionality. So how it is to be judged? The principle of proportionality is to be applied. The principle which was laid down was, in the first instance, we have to see the scope of constitutional right, whether a particular right claimed by the petitioner amounts to fundamental right at all or not. Because there the question was, as I told you, privacy, whether they were dispute privacy is fundamental right at all or not. There were some judgments, earlier contradictory judgments. But then in this case, the court held that yes, it is a fundamental right. So first issue will be, if I am claiming some right, I have to bring it within the four corners of my fundamental right. Only then I get the constitutional right. Then second would be, if the answer is affirmative, then embark on the inquiry on the limitation of the constitutional right. So whether the act which is there, whether that limits the fundamental right. If it doesn't, then no further question arises. But if it does, then the third question, the third would be whether such an act is sanctioned by law. Because fundamental right, if it is established under the Constitution and Article 19, 2 to 6, which I said, and other also, then act has to be backed by law. Law should be passed. It can't be an administrative act. It has to be by a statutory act, the limitation is imposed. So that has to be, if there's no law passed to deal with that, then the matter ends there only, the act will be set aside if it amounts to limitation. Then fourth is, if law is also passed, now the test of proportionality comes. If there is a law imposing such limitation, the role of proportionality comes into picture. And what this says is that now we have to undertake the inquiry on, again, the court set 4 parameters. What are the 4 parameters in order to decide that a particular action is proportionate or not? Now here, first is the designate, it is designated for a proper purpose. Limitation is imposed. Limitation is imposed to achieve some purpose. The example which I gave of that, say, mines, purpose was to conserve the forest environment. So, of course, how it is to be valued, etc., evaluated, and how balancing is to be done will be seen. But first is, purpose should be proper purpose. If the purpose is not proper, the action would be set aside. The second would be, the measure undertaken to effectuate such a limitation are rationally connected to the fulfillment of that purpose. That you have taken a measure, and it is the test under Article 14 also, that when reasonable classification is based on rational objective which is sought to be achieved, it has nexus with the objective which is sought to be achieved. So it has some purpose, it has connectivity is to be maintained. If it has served no purpose, purpose may be good, but limitation act which I am taking serves no purpose at all. Suppose I say, take the example of that mines, I'm saying forest area. If the petitioner is able to prove that, look, yes, for conservation of forest, you can say, but the land is not situated in forest area. This land is outside forest area. If that is proved, then it has no connection. Purpose may be good, but it is not achieved here. Land is the non-forest area. So that kind of example I'm giving. Then the third is that the measure undertaken are necessary in the sense that there is no alternative measure. As I remember, I told you the doctrine of necessity, which was propounded in 1997 by Justice M.J. Rao in that the judgment. There is no other alternative, this had to be done. And because it is least intrusive, method should be, if there are other alternative of lesser degree, then that should be chosen. Then this should not have come. And the fourth is, then again, this is a proper relation between importance of achieving the purpose and social importance of preventing that limitation, which we call stricto sensu balancing. The court will still see whether balancing can be done and the rigors of that limitation can be eased in order to maintain that proportionality. If the balancing is not done, still it can be seen. If I say at the end, applying these tests, if I come to now Aadhaar judgment, when it came to main Aadhaar, scheme of Aadhaar, we said that this Aadhaar is good because it is going to serve the purpose of the those who are illiterate, those who are poor, because many benefits under various welfare schemes are to be given to them. And with Aadhaar, identity is proved and they will be able to receive. When otherwise we know in our country, as Rajiv Gandhi, when he was Prime Minister, also said, if 1 rupee is spent by the government, actual money which is received by the recipient is only 15 paisa out of that. 85 paisa are frittered away in between. It will be ensured that the money goes to the concerned person because of his unique identity and into his account. So entire 1 rupee goes, so therefore it is serving a proper purpose, public purpose. So therefore it meets the, and we have seen over a time period of time, various measures have been adopted which have not been successful in pilfering the amounts, etc. in between. So therefore, if today this is the method which is adopted, which the only method available, it should be. But at the same time, when it came to this, Aadhaar was made mandatory for so many other things. If you have to apply for telephone, you should have Aadhaar. If you have to apply for a bank account, you have to open a bank account, you should have Aadhaar. And we were given the examples, even a person who is taken a dead body to a cremation ground, and the body is not cremated unless Aadhaar is produced. He said, what is the use? What is the purpose? I mean, although you are saying objective is there, but it is there are so many other alternatives. If you see, we were said that it should be minimum intrusion and no other alternative is possible at all. So it amounts to infringing the privacy of a person where such a purpose can be achieved by other methods. So all those provisions were shut down by the Supreme Court, if you read the judgment, on the ground of proportionality. So therefore, this is the proportionality by which purpose is achieved. At the same time, balancing is done in order to achieve the just and fair solution of a problem. That is how this has become now a tool more in administrative service law and criminal law. It was already there, but more in administrative law and much more in constitutional law today. Thank you very much.
So thank you. The way you have balancing the entire topic in a nice manner itself is an art which has to be learned. To connect the criminal law, administrative law, Ventspinelli principle, doctrine of proportionality, doctrine of sustainable, these all I think those also who have participated in this webinar or those who would be subsequently looking in the videos, they need not go to any books, etc., because it's all things kar lo duniya mutthi mein. That is the precise which I can say in a precise word. So the questions have come.
Mr. Chatter, this praise is disproportional. I don't
that much. No, sir, on these two principles, you definitely, and Mr. Mutneja is there, and he wanted to ask a question. He's a practicing lawyer. He has appeared frequently before you while you were the Chief Justice out here. Mr. Pawan Kumar Mutneja, he wants to ask a question to you.
I know him well. When I was lawyer, we have done so many cases together in Chandigarh. Yes, he was with Mr. Jawaharlal Gupta at that time.
Yes. Good evening, sir. It was a very enlightening talk on on the doctrine of proportionality. But there is one other aspect which needs to be factored in. Proportionality, all right, but how do you factor in compassion in the degree of punishment? What actually happens? For example, dismissal is awarded pursuant to an inquiry in a case of misappropriation. The bench agrees with the misappropriation and says, yes, on the doctrine of proportionality, dismissal is the punishment. But then he says, the amount misappropriated is very small. And then says, how is this person going to sustain himself? Therefore, goes on to say, all right, you reinstate him or you give so much this thing. How do you factor in that compassion in this doctrine of proportionality? That's what I wanted to
ask. You see, if you remember, it's a very interesting and good question, Mr. Mutneja. As I told you, doctrine of proportionality is one thing, but along with that, you have to see, as I said, although in criminal band, by touching that aspect, many mitigating and extenuating circumstances. So here, of course, again, and I said that, look, when it comes to in the service law only, proportionality, one judge on the same facts may take an opinion that no, it is reasonable, because as you know, and you are the expert in service law, that as far as embezzlement is concerned, even some people, yes, and judgment of the Supreme Court also, yes. The amount of money is no consideration, even if it is 10 rupees. DTC conductors, etc., that bus conductors who are not giving tickets and taking only 2 rupees, 5 rupees in old 70s, 80s, were given the punishment of dismissal, which were upheld, that the amount is not, but it is the intention. Intention was to commit that embezzlement and cheating, etc., which is more important. Any other judge would say that, look, we have to go into, I still remember, it was, I was told, I think justice and at that time it is before 1966, where Delhi High Court, Delhi did not have its own High Court, and it was Punjab's circuit bench which used to be. I've forgotten the name of the judge who had come to Delhi, and my father told me that instance, and he was hearing that matter, and it was again embezzlement or this cheating, etc., by an employee of 100 rupees, and he jokingly said to the counsel or respondent, the government, 100 rupees, and you want to snatch his livelihood? What is this nonsense? Sorry, reinstate him, and we will give award lesser punishment. So how the thing is perceived by the two, compassion for one may become a part of proportionality. To describe it as shockingly disproportionate, and compassion may not be taken into consideration by others, and he will say, no, sorry, it's a case of cheating or embezzlement. Money is not the consideration, and therefore, this is the conduct which is more important, and sorry, I am not going. So compassion in that sense may become relevant, even while to decide, or not decide, rather give an opinion whether I think a particular act to be disproportionate or not disproportionate.
Thank you, sir.
So I am reminded that invariably in corruption cases, one line in the judgments is invariably written that a drop of poison in the entire milk can spoil the entire milk. Therefore, while upholding the dismissal, this line is invariably I found in the judgments, when you try to tinker with the aspect that it has to be tinkered with, that but when the learned judge wants to uphold it, he generally invariably holds that the drop of poison is enough to spoil the entire milk. So the amount of corruption is not important.
You, I have, yes, yeah, very correct. And I've seen even in the cases of say indiscipline in service in army matters, that is whether it's army, air force, etc. So some judges would say, if suppose it's a for 10 days or 15 days one person has not come, yeah, and you know, under the Army Act, etc., then the law is very rigorous. Somebody would say, sorry, in a discipline, army discipline, in an army, this thing, we are not ready to tolerate this discipline. Had it been a case in civilian service, we would have reinstated, but not such a person who would, and they are declared deserter, etc., even for 15 days, 10 days, they don't come. But any other judge may say, look, for 15 days, 10 days, if you had 20 years service, why you are doing all this? So ultimately, how a particular judge perceives, because all these are at the same time lose in a way the expressions, which may have so many connotations and which can be described and looked into the doctrine of reasonableness. One thing may be perceived as reasonable by you, unreasonable by me. Why we don't bring morality into the legal aspects, because again the contours and the passages of morality in law may be totally different. One may think a particular thing is moral, other may think it is immoral. So therefore, but at the same time, when the decision is to be taken, I am of the view, and which is stated by so many jurists also, how judges decide cases. There's a very nice book by Professor Dworkin of Oxford University. Very, very nice book, What Goes Into the Mind. There are many others who have also written, and have, as a judge, I have read all these books for other interest also, not only that how we should decide the cases. But then he says that it develops various theories, etc., on the basis. So, but ultimately, there are so many concepts in law which have no definite connotations. But what I'm saying is, they have said that while giving the judgment, the judge should lay down some norms on the basis of which he applies. That is one attempt which I made in that dental college NEET judgment, that I defined, which I read these exercises, etc. I defined these are the parameters on which you undertake this exercise. These are the stages on which you take this exercise. This is what I laid down, which was ultimately accepted in a Puttuswamy case by 9-judge judgment also. And therefore, some norm should be there at the back. It should not be only one or two lines in the wisdom. Then tomorrow, that may be followed as precedent, may not be followed as precedent. But if it is backed by some norm, some normative value is attached to a judgment, then it has its solid value. This is what I've always believed.
So like you were saying, while reading the judgments on the service matter, I have also seen, as what you were saying on the disciplinary proceedings, disciplined forces. They used to say that the absence in a disciplinary force, that the rigor of discipline has to be more. And therefore, let's assume a conductor was on leave, was absent without duty. He could be reinstated, but for an armed forces, and especially once he's on a border, etc., then the tinkering with the dismissal order is not. So Mr. Jaydeep asked, do you see any difference of relationship between doctrine of proportionality and doctrine of reasonable restrictions?
You see, no, difference is there in the sense, doctrine of reasonableness originated from common law, as I said earlier. And of course, the theoretical or jurisprudential basis may be the same. That a thing should be reasonable means it should not be disproportionate also. Reasonableness may have various facets, and proportionality becomes one of that. But when we apply the doctrine of proportionality, and particularly that is why I have tried to distinguish, and this is entirely my own, what I read from, and my, from my own experience, what we have read in criminal law, what we have read in administrative law, what we have read in service matters, and what we have read in constitutional matters, and giving you these judgments, this all entire hypothesis which I have described today, I have developed it myself. But then what I'm saying is, when we apply the doctrine of proportionality, in applying the doctrine of proportionality, then you come to certain stages, certain tests, how it is to be applied. So in that sense, it becomes little normative and the exercise becomes little pragmatic and little more scientific than applying the abstract doctrine of reasonableness. That may be the difference. Otherwise, to some extent or to large extent, they would be overlapped.
So Harshit Pran, it is invariably, so shed some light on the internet censorship and idea of proportionality. Should we include the idea of morality? This is by Naveen.
But you see, if you want, I'll come give another lecture totally on morality and law. It needs 1 hour again to explain all this. There would be so many. But as I told you in the brief, that it is Lon Fuller, a great jurist, has said every law has its inner morality. The doctrine of, I'm only touching some of the facets only and flagging it. The in the constitutional law, we read one phrase, silences of the constitution. What is silences of the constitution? That means the constitution, which is not stated in black letters, but it is still read into it. Now, Article 21, if right to life and liberty is interpreted to mean that right to live life of dignity, and dignity, the Supreme Court has given now 40 rights. These are all silences of the Constitution. And touching upon the only the moral aspects, the theory of or the doctrine of basic features of the Constitution, and any basic feature is described in Constitution anywhere, nowhere. But in Keshavananda Bharati, the Supreme Court came out with this theory. These are the silences or the morality. And then when we come to morality, very clearly, the constitutional morality, which is again the doctrine propounded in so many judgments and lately by, recently in many judgments by Justice Deepak Mishra, starting from Manohar Narula in 2014, and then coming to Government of NCT versus Union of India, and even in Euthanasia and thereafter in this Sabrimala, etc., in cases he has expanded constitutional morality, and in this Navtej Johar 377 judgment by Justice Chandrachud also, and to some extent Justice Roynton Narimon also. So this morality is even in Bible, they say that this constitution also has some morality in it, distinct inherent morality. But then on the one hand, this morality is there, constitutional morality, which is read by the judges into that, in what form, again, it needs a detailed discussion. On the other hand, there is a strong criticism that, look, if we go by this, what is that constitutional morality will depend upon the wisdom or whims of a particular judge. He may read those a particular aspect as morality and will make it a fundamental right, or will make it a duty of the government, etc., would enforce it, and other judges may not. So therefore, we should not have in the constitution such precepts or such principles which are not solid or which are not cogent and which are susceptible of any kinds of meaning. So therefore, this is a matter of debate whether morality should be read into it or not. But many, I gave the name, as far as jurists are concerned, Lon Fuller has said, Dworkin has said, even Dworkin, if you read Justice for Hedgehogs, and then his another very celebrated book, which is there, I've forgotten his name, that he has also propounded the theory of morality into it and how morality is to be read. But yes, for that, if you want me to give a full discourse, then that needs, all your law professors are there, in jurisprudence, they can teach you on that.
So basically, what we have gathered is, before we take the questions, request would be kindly climb slightly to the mic, probably with the advent, with the flux of time, you slightly go on further from the mic, therefore there is some disturbance.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, so it's better. Supreme Court in Puthuswamy's case judgment observed that the principle of proportionality is inherent in our constitution. But while in Anuradha Bhasin's case upheld right to freedom of speech and do business over internet. But then recently Supreme Court did not allow 4G judgment, internet and 2G. Is this form of implicit internet shutdown? So that is a comment we will not take upon. Whether the Avinash Singh, whether irrational and perversity are recognized rounds of judicial review?
Yes, as it is, this is one of the part of principle of bench bodies, which I told you.
Okay.
Illegality, irrationality, and this impropriety, procedural impropriety. It is covered by that.
Thank you. Himanshu Kanda is a student in Patiala. Many cases in courts are pending as witness turned hostile. As statement recorded by police is not recommended in court. And when witnesses change their statement in court, there is no harsh punishment. In section 193 of ICC states that punishment for false evidence or false statement, but it takes a long time to prove that evidence in delay. In America, a friend of Donald Trump, Roger Strom, jailed only because he lied to Congress. And former National Security Advisor to Trump, Michael Flynn, is also waiting to go to jail as he lied to FBI. But in India, if a person is having approached the courts closed, we should adopt the policy of America. What is your take on this, sir?
I entirely agree with that. That is one line if I state so. Because it's not only there. How much perjury is committed in our pleadings? A plaint is filed and the statement, everything is denied. And denied even when they know that what they are denying is wrong. And on oath, it is supported by affidavit also. Ultimately, finding is given that what was stated was lie, but no action is taken. And that is one reason that this kind of litigation goes on in our country. The only problem is what I feel is many times even Section 340 CRPC applications are filed that the other side has committed perjury and you refer the matter for prosecution. And sometime it is done, sometime it is not done. The courts take little lenient view in these matters. Maybe because of the reason that, look, we are already saddled with so many cases. The arrears are, so should we add to the cases? But then according to me, that is not the answer. On the contrary, when we are saddled with so many cases, many of these cases are totally frivolous. Either defense is frivolous or the plaint, etc., the prosecution, those cases will go out of the system if there's some retribution, if there's some deterrent by punishing those who are conducting in this manner. So I entirely agree with it.
We have Prabhas Bajaj. He's practicing in Delhi. He's a good friend of mine. He has assisted. He brought to us Mr. Maninder Singh on this platform. He wants to ask a question to you. He's as reliable as Hamara Bajaj scooter ad.
Good evening, sir. Sir, thank you for such an engaging and enlightening session. And we learned so much. And I would just like to ask you one question. You had mentioned the sentencing policy, which is prevalent in America. Sir, based on your immense experience on the bench, would you say that the discretion which is now available to the judges in India on sentencing is better, or should we also have some kind of a similar sentencing policy with some broad guidelines on how any person should be sentenced?
Both the systems have its own pros and cons, its own advantages and disadvantages. Insofar as American system is concerned, it is so rigid. And many times when a particular case, suppose like we have this principle of mitigating and extenuating circumstances, etc., which American judges can't go into that, because once the sentencing policy, if the offense is this, first offense, it has to be this much punishment, and there's no discretion with the judge. So even when there were mitigating, and these mitigating circumstances are those, if you know, which the Supreme Court, Indian Supreme Court has laid down, or the other courts have laid down, they all tend to arrive at justice in a matter. Because going by the age, the sex, the circumstances in which the offense was committed, etc., all those become very relevant. So therefore, those are some of the weaknesses of the American system. Advantages of that system is that it brings objectivity, that I know if such and such crime is committed, this is the punishment which is going to be there, come what may. So it becomes objectivity, and in a way, Article 14 is also not violated. All are treated equally when they say. But in given some cases, some circumstances, it may lead to injustice. In Indian context, I would say that if sentencing policy is not there, discretion is there. In certain cases, in order to arrive at just sentencing, these circumstances may become important. But the problem is, I'm very frankly saying, as a judge, I was a judge, and that how the judges look into this. And that is why we know that we have the judges. He's pro the conviction judge. He's pro acquittal judge, and all that. We know we have judges. He is pro tenant judge. He's pro landlord. So in the context of this criminal law, then we know there are some judges. Okay, you go to this judge, particular judge, and even if it is a very diabolical crime where this death sentence is given up to the High Court, Supreme Court is going to commute it. And a reverse other judge, where even if life imprisonment is given by the High Court, that this judge may convert it into the death sentence. So therefore, this discretion which is to be exercised, and here I'm talking of High Court or Supreme Court judges, what to talk of magistrates and additional session judges, etc. But the discretion which is to be exercised on objective considerations, that art and that science is to be learned. It is very, very necessary. Otherwise, this discretion is not exercised properly. And that is what we witness day in and day out. And that is why we feel many times in Indian context that, look, justice is not done. Two cases are not given similar treatment. And that is why it is very unfortunate. But it is a fact. There is this feeling among the public that those who are mighty and high, they are able to get away with very lesser punishments, even if their crime is same. So therefore, this discretion, the manner in which it is exercised, when such cases come, we feel the absence of system like US system, that had it been there, then all these cases would have been treated alike. So yes, that is my take on both.
Sir, if I may be permitted to say one more thing. My senior, Mr. Maninder Singh, has always told us about how he had benefited from being taught by you in law faculty in the 80s. And now, thankfully, because of your sessions,
he was my student, and he is today additional secretary general. He was now. He is not additional.
Now, sir,
one of the best counsel in Delhi.
Thanks to your session, sir, now we can also tell him that we have also been benefited from the same teacher.
Thank you very much.
Prabhas wants to say kal, aaj aur kal is same, ultimately. Time has its own factor. So we won't take any questions because we are at 6:35. Just a five minutes wrap up like we usually do. This time, because we have already taken the insights from you how to become a good lawyer. Now just one question from your side.
Yes, sir. Komal wants to say something.
Sir, Komal is to formally give a vote of thanks. She will ask the question.
I said vote of thanks and question.
You can do together.
Okay, fine.
Because she is to formally give a vote of thanks. She is an assistant director in Jaipur University. So just one question, for all lawyers, budding lawyers and other lawyers also. Like, you have been able to gather not only the law aspects, but different proportionality principles, etc., etc. And one aspect which I learned from today is that the zeal to deliver with such vast experience, it could have been, you could have come straight away on the platform, just off the cuff, given a talk, and for one and a half hour, the time would have flown like anything. But to gather all facts, to ensure that what, like Prabhas said, that Mr. Maninder Singh had been a beneficiary, and we have been beneficiary of the two lectures that otherwise we had attended in the judicial academies also. One, what is the factor that motivates you to do better and better, and that is why you are totally engrossed with all these webinars up to 30th? And I was just checking it out. Totally. Yes, sir.
This is just passion. passion only. Passion to learn more and more. I want to learn even at this stage. I tell you, I had given some time ago a couple of years ago a lecture on this proportionality, right? And that has been published in this SCC journal also. But for today's lecture, I could have simply done one thing, could have picked up that and said, but I said, no, let me improve upon that. And really, if you read that lecture, read that in the SCC journal and what I said today, we'll find a lot of improvement, because for 2-3 days, I studied on this. I studied all those judgments which I told you and developed my hypothesis on how this has been developed in this, which you will not find in that. So therefore, you have to, because even what I have said today, I feel that it, even this can be improved. So tomorrow, if I have to give after 1 year lecture on the same topic, I will revisit all over again. So that is the passion. I feel that, yes, there is always a scope for improvement. So keep on honing your skills, keep on learning more and more things, keep on improving what you have learned already. So that is what I feel everybody should do. I do that. I learned it from my seniors, and that is what I can advise.
So a point well taken. I like what you said, it could have been done. Two points I will just to add to it. They say, like, let's assume it's Virat Kohli. He says that he could be the best player, but he should have said that I could straight away go and play the match. But he practices before that. That shows that practice as a lawyer, practice as a judge is the master, number one. And they say whatsoever axe is the sharpener of the knife, which is sharp, it has to be sharpened every day so that it continues to become more sharper. Therefore, the skills as a lawyer, one has to sharpen his skills. That is what we have learned, taking cue from you. So, though we had asked no questions, but Mr. B.K. Mehta, probably you might be knowing he was in the judicial services, higher judicial services. How to accept that the statement laid before the court by the police is the gospel truth? Padding, fabrication of evidence, etc. are the traits of an Anglo-Saxon style of policing. We are still continuing with. What is your take? How to control it?
There's hardly any answer to be given. Everybody knows the answer also, and he's very right. And he has done more as a session judge, more such cases, and he has come across more such problems than me. Our problem is that our police, even today, when it comes to investigation, adopts same kind of tactics which were 100 or 50 or 60 years ago. That if you see most of the cases, yes, the evidence before a police officer, the statement or the given before the police officer is not admissible. Section 25, we know, but they will take the shelter of Section 27, will catch hold, and even if a particular thing is already discovered, they will make it as if this discovery is led, they had led to this discovery because of the statement given by him, and ignore what I say, and which has been said by so many time and again. Today, we have so much of technology. If that technology is used in investigation, then all these things are not needed. But we still are in believing in that archaic system, and our police goes into that. In police reforms, and many lectures are given there also, they said that used, of course, in some of the crimes like enforcement directorates or white collar crimes or cyber crimes, etc., technology is used by the police, but not in those the traditional crimes like this murder or dacoity or other things where the still old kinds of tactics are used by the police, and then they falter in the court because of so many reasons, and everybody knows the reason, and that is why the conviction rate is also less. And one reason could be, and I'm very frank in saying so, they may be intentionally doing so just to help the criminal.
Thank you. They say they say in the police only three things work: nazrana, shukrana, and jurmana. It all depends how you grease the palms or how you exert your pressures. So before we part, thank you for all the participants, and I will ask Professor Komal to ask a question in this thing. But again, I am taking the cue from your judgment itself, and it is again dedicated to you. It's not important to be the number one, but it is important to be unique, because unique is the only one. And that's purely dedicated to you, because you're unique in its own style, your art of presentation, your art of placement of facts. And the fact that there were 4 webinars, I just received a message. The Honorable Chief Justice was there. Honorable Justice Sanjay Kishan Kaul's webinar was there. Mr. Aman Lekhi's webinar is there. still people are watching us live on the Facebook, and large participants are there. We are all thankful to you for sparing the time. And the fact that in one of the, while delivering this thing, you said that I will require one more webinar on that. So we take a cue from that. May you are busy. June, come June, and we are much stronger, much, much better to participate in the webinars. Over to Professor Komal, and thank you. Stay safe, stay home. Over to you, Professor Komal.
Thank you.
Good evening, sir. Good evening to all the participants. My question is that you just talked about right to privacy and the case of K. Puttuswamy. So on May 1st, the state, through the executive action, made an order that the Arogya Setu, use of Arogya Setu, has been made compulsory for private and public employees, as well as the people staying in containment zone. And it is not that only. It has been penalized also under Disaster Management Act 2005 and Section 188 of IPC, that's the disobedience to the public officer. Now, had it been, appropriate in the sense it had all the remedies, it had all the reasonable degree of protection, because the government itself mentions there that it won't be liable if the third party gets access to it. So my question is, in the absence of proper legal framework, in the absence of data protection laws, in the absence of any evidence of the efficacy of this Arogya Setu, because they are asking us to download it on smartphones, and although we have so many million...
Komal.
Yeah, the question is, how
my,
the state...
My simple answer,
Yes.
I understood the question. My simple answer would be that, look, it is, you are right, a matter which is debated much. And even we know, we have been hearing those debates, etc., and people are talking about it, that it is an intrusion into the privacy. And whether, of course, is there, it is under Disaster Management Act, as you have yourself mentioned. The question is, when it is applied on the doctrine of proportionality, the question would be whether this was the only way to check this corona and this Arogya Setu, etc., or there were other ways also, and whether it meets the test of proportionality or not. It will be, I don't want to express my personal view at the moment, I have a view on this, but only because this matter is going to be tested in the court tomorrow. So let us see what courts decide.
Because the French hacker, you know, who export that Aadhaar card, he has again sent a message on Twitter that the privacy of 90 million Indians are at stake. So can you contact me in private? The same French...
I tell you, Professor Komal, it raises very, very serious issues of privacy. No doubt about it. No doubt about it. Because everybody is so much afraid and apprehensive of this COVID. Nobody is today taking much action. But then I think this... it is going to come before the court, and court will have to take a call on this.
Thank you so much, sir. And I feel very privileged to propose vote of thanks, and on the behalf of the organizers as well as the participants, and my heartfelt gratitude to you for taking out time from your busy schedule. And you know, we had heard so much about your erudition and oratory skills in the courtroom. So today we have been very, very fortunate to witness that. And thank you so much for enlightening us, you know, on the very important doctrine of proportionality. And also my heartfelt, you know, thanks to Vikasji also, because he has been holding these webinars, you know, and they have been so intellectually vibrating, and the wonderful topics he has chosen, you know, every time, you know, it's relating to legal education, profession, and then the legal practice, and also the administration of justice, and by calling all those outstanding judges, lawyers, and jurists. I think in the end, I might be participated in this, because the webinar wouldn't have been possible. And in the end, during this lockdown period, I will just say that, you know, you will never know about your strength unless you face challenges. And I think Vikas ji is making that struggle, you know, very nice. That way we can, utilizing our time in the creativity of this, attending this, these webinars and all. Thank you so much, sir. It was a great pleasure.
Before we part, I just tell that ma'am Komal is also from Chandigarh. She's a 85 pass out. I connected through.
And okay. I was a student of Justice Jagdishan Gupta. So I had wonderful teachers, Faras Diwan sir, Bangia sir. So that way, like sir said, I always improvise my lecture. I also do the same thing. Thank you so much, sir.
Sir, thank you everyone. Sir, time हमारा निकल गया और वो कहते हैं पानी रेत की तरह है और रेत की तरह है समय वो कब बीत जाए पता ही नहीं चलता और वही हुआ आज. Thank you sir. Thank you once again.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you everyone. Stay safe.
Thank you sir.